Hey guys, it's Danny. How are you guys doing? I hope you're all okay. Hope you all had a great time around the holidays if you celebrated. If you didn't, I still hope you had a great time. I still hope you're okay. I am excited to just get out of the holiday season and focus on work again. I really, really need to focus on work and get my mind off of things because things are not always peachy, but hey, that's life. However, though, I am letting you know that for a little while, at least for a few days, we're just gonna take it a little easy. I don't really feel like getting into very heavy subjects with orchids and experiments just yet. We're gonna take it slow. Please bear with me. We're gonna have some discussions pretty much. I'm trying to focus on videos, but I cannot like fully focus on them anyway. So with that said, today we're just gonna focus on the Oncidiums. Remember, I made that video with success and fails for 2018 and I told you the problematic group was the Oncidium group. Well, I figured out why. A couple of weeks ago, I started to repot them. I told you I was gonna try moss. Well, in doing so, I figured out what the problem is. So this is what we're gonna talk about today. I'm gonna reference an older video that I made. And yeah, it's just going to be a theoretical discussion and I hope it's interesting. So with that said, let's start with the problematic Oncidiums. Now, just for the record, I will say Oncidiums in this video, but in this group, I shall refer to the intergenerics, even to Miltonias, the Miltonidiums, whatever hybrids are related to Oncidiums. There is just so much reclassification lately that I don't feel like checking the IRHS all of the time. And personally, I'm not really concerned about taxonomy and being 100% correct in this department. I'm more interested in being efficient. So if you have an issue with me saying Oncidiums and actually pointing at a Miltonia, it's okay. It's not that important. So I will talk about the Oncidiums as a tribe, but also I will refer to fine-rooted orchids generally. So to better explain the issue that I noticed, I need to start with the beginning, with LECA itself, because otherwise I think it will be a little incoherent. So let's start with the properties of LECA. Now, LECA itself, paradoxically enough, is not a very water-retentive medium. It's also not a very wicking medium either. We use it because it's inorganic, that's the first criteria we're interested in, and also because it maintains its shape, it's round, and retains a lot of air pockets. It is a very, very aerated and ventilated medium. We use it, however, in most cases with a reservoir type of setup, with a hydroponic setup. Be it semi-hydro, self-watering, pure hydroponics without a reservoir, but just submerged in water, and so on and so forth. As a standalone medium, it's not all that efficient in retaining water. It can be used, but only under certain circumstances when water retention is not something we're after. So all of the setups that I have with LECA do have reservoirs, whether they're semi-hydroponics or self-watering. I don't use LECA as it is because it's just as efficient as bark. And right now I'm looking for moisture retention stuff. Now, in most cases, and as you saw in that video, it works really well with most orchids. Phalaenopsis, Dendrobium phalaenopsis, Cattleyas, and Graecums, other orchids which have more robust roots, they're all doing great. However, there are the fine-rooted orchids which don't do as great in LECA. Why wouldn't they do so great for me in LECA? Well, because their roots are really, really different from a phalaenopsis or a cattleya root or even an engraecum root. If we look at the spot, we can see that the top layer of LECA is pretty dry, and there are roots which are pretty dry as well on the top, the aerial roots. But there are roots which go into the potting medium, and they appear to be wet. I have a few on this side as well. It's only the roots that actually go inside the pot which are wet. Why is that? Well, because the layer at the top is dry, but layers at the bottom are actually wet. And the velamen itself around the root is wicking. It acts like a wick and pretty much directs water from the bottom to the top. In its way, it wets a little bit the LECA as well. By wetting the LECA, we make the nutrients available again. The orchid is not dehydrated because obviously it does get hydration, it does get nutrients. But this doesn't happen with all orchids. The finer rooted orchids are not capable of wicking the water in the same way. Oncidiums are actually known for loving a lot of moisture around their root system. However, their roots are usually pretty fine in comparison to a phalaenopsis. There are other species of orchids which prefer a lot of moisture as well and have fine roots, such as the bulbophyllums. And luckily, I did move my bulbophyllums quite a while back. And if we take a look at their roots today, we can see they're actually doing very, very well. They're doing a lot better in this setup than they did in pure LECA. We still have LECA attached to them, but that's okay. LECA aerates the environment, but the moss is just so wicking and so even that the roots really don't stop growing. They don't actually have any issue, and the orchid stopped presenting dehydration signs. So the problem here is a combination of things. LECA itself is not compatible with orchids with fine roots, which prefer a lot of moisture in my environment. I don't know if that made any sense, but considering the properties of LECA, it's easy to see how sometimes you can get a lot of layering, particularly in very warm climates, very aerated, ventilated climates, and so on and so forth. Some orchids can overcome that, such as the fowls and cats and all of the thick-rooted orchids, but some, the fine-rooted ones, don't overcome this. I discover that their velamen, their roots are not all that wicking in comparison to the other orchids. They might be, but definitely LECA starts to remove the moisture from the roots as well if it's very, very dry. And Oncidiums and other fine-rooted orchids, they cannot cope with LECA if it's dry. Now, repotting my Oncidiums, I discovered this exact issue. A lot of layering that made roots simply stop growing. They didn't branch out either like I wanted them to due to the dry layer. Now, the issue became worse in winter time, and you might think it's because I heat up my grow space. Not really, because my grow space is a lot cooler right now than it is in summer. In summer, it can get pretty hot. The thing is, I water less often. The water doesn't evaporate as much as it did in the summertime. Therefore, it didn't help the pot with staying moist. Also, even if I had quite a lot of water in the reservoir, the top layer would have been very, very dry. I knew that the very top would be dry. I just didn't think the entire half, upper half of the pot was completely, almost completely dry. It is that severe because in the summertime I would water more often and I would water from the top and inevitably wet the top, including the roots. But in winter, because the reservoir stays full for longer, I don't water as often. Therefore, the top just dries up because I just don't re-wet it, if that makes sense. So the problems became worse in winter because of my watering routine. Now, to solve this issue, there are a few things that I could do. I'm sure at this point many of you are tempted to type, Danny, use a top layer of sphagnum moss. Well, there are a few issues with that. First of all, I personally don't like to mix sphagnum moss with LECA because moss will inevitably start to clog the air pockets. And also, the top layer wouldn't help me much because the severity of the issue is not regarding the top of the pot either. I have at least half of the pot dry, if not more. So adding a top layer of moss doesn't really help all that much. I would need to add half of the pot moss. And at this point, if I'm adding half of the pot moss, might as well make it all moss because I can make it fluffy. Some orchids also had LECA around their roots. I didn't remove them, so there is some LECA there, but you can see why it's not really efficient to use moss and LECA purposely. I would much rather have it full moss and have it evenly moist than trying to make it half moss or more than half moss and a little bit of LECA at the bottom. There's no use for LECA at the bottom. So that was one thing I could have done. Another thing I could have done is to start watering more often these orchids and practically wet the top more often, dump out the reservoir so I don't overfill it. This is not something that I can do right now in my point in life. I wish I would have more time to spend with orchids and maintain them, but I cannot do it at the moment, so I have to scrap that at least for the time being. And a third option is, of course, to use full sphagnum moss and get rid of all headaches. And as you could see with the other bulbophyllums, that seems to have worked very, very well. And it's not only the bulbophyllums which enjoy full moss, it's also the Oncidiums, as you'll see later in the video. Now, I do have a very, very old video in which I talk about semi-hydro and how it's absolutely not for me. It simply didn't go with my environment then. And in that video, I talk about trying semi-hydro with an Oncidium in summertime, which completely failed. I had to water it way too often for my liking because I had a lot of layering. And I actually got a comment recently saying, so I guess this video doesn't reflect your opinion anymore, or it's not accurate anymore. It is. All of my videos are accurate because it's what I thought then. As we experiment more, we learn, obviously. But in this case, it still reflects my opinion. Back then I tried it with an Oncidium, it didn't work. Now I tried it with Oncidiums again, I'm not extremely happy. Many other people with other climates different than mine do grow Oncidiums very, 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 very well in semi-hydro or LECA or hydroponics media. It's a mixture of things. The environment doesn't help me at all, and also my availability doesn't help me at all either. All of these things make it so that for some people, semi-hydro is great with Oncidiums. For me, it's absolutely not. And let me just show you what difference sphagnum moss did to one of my Oncidium types. Okay, so this is the Cheyenne orchid. I showed you her before, I showed you the roots before, but every day that I look at them, I am more and more surprised, because this orchid did not have roots. It had issues growing roots in LECA. At this moment, the roots are simply taking over the pot. It is absolutely unbelievable, the root production on this orchid. I'm so incredibly happy. So that's the difference. This is not what I was seeing with my other Oncidiums. The roots didn't grow properly. They just stopped growing. They didn't even branch properly. And this flower spike is threatening to break. There we go. So the difference is absolutely immense. Happily though, I have more orchids which do like LECA than the ones that really don't like LECA. One of the drawbacks of any organic media is that it's not cost efficient. And when you have a lot of orchids, changing bark and sphagnum moss periodically means additional costs. If we invest in a good quality medium, we won't really have to change it as often, but in the end, it's still not as cost efficient as LECA, which can be reused after sterilization. But if we are to think about our orchids, it is okay to choose the non-cost efficient option until further notice. I don't have a very, very big Oncidium collection anyway. I can do with moss. It is cost efficient for how I use it, how fluffy and airy I use it. Being that I use it in self-watering means that I can use just tiny amounts of sphagnum moss. I don't need to pack the pot. So with the fine rooted orchids and Oncidiums, I can still do with sphagnum moss and it's okay. But yeah, there we go. That's the issue with LECA and Oncidiums in my climate. But it's okay, it just means we're still searching for an inorganic replacement for sphagnum moss. Alrighty guys, so this has been it for today's video. I hope you guys found this useful, and yeah, bear with me, you know how it is. Sometimes we need to focus on real life situation, and even though, you know, I don't want to, I'd much rather focus on videos and on orchid growing and things of the sorts. For a little while, we need to kind of do both, and that is that. But everything is okay, everything is all right. You know how it is, we all have to go through bumps, but they will pass. So alrighty guys, thank you so much for watching, hope you've enjoyed this. You know the drill, like or dislike this video below, subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As and other fun orchid subjects, and if you like YouTube to notify you whenever I upload a new video, just turn on notifications for my channel. Also, if you're interested in all of my setups, the products that I use and all of that, again, check the description, I list everything there. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!